you know, the institutionalization of disciplines has been a process that has been going on from anywhere from 50 to, say, 200 years, depending on which discipline one is speaking about. Now, if you look at something like political science, I mean, there was a time when political science meant largely the study of a number of things, such as the relationship of the state to the individual. Political theory, right? So what responsibilities does the state owe to the individual, and vice versa? What is the nature of political action? What do we even mean by politics? You know, is politics simply only electoral democracy, you know, the parliament, the state? And of course, now we have come to the realization that that would be a wholly inadequate understanding what politics means, because grassroots movements, movements led by women, by workers, and so on, all operate outside the state. And that is part of what we would understand as politics. So if you look at political science as a discipline, it's very clear that there was a time when political science meant largely what today one would understand as politics and political theory. And what's interesting is that over the course of the last 50 years, particularly since the institutionalization of political science, which, by the way, is a really an American discipline. I mean, no European university ever really had something called political science, right? So the Americans basically institutionalize it. You know, they create a whole set of journals, the American Political Science Association Journal, the American Political Science Review, things like that. And when they do it, they essentially really, in a sense, over a period of a couple of decades, transform this so that it becomes the most retrograde thing you can think of. So political scientists, for example, I would argue today, are probably the least likely of the social scientists to actually look, for the most part, at workers' movements, movements on the ground, grassroots movements, or to look at political theory. Political theory has, in fact, largely vanished, you know? So if you want to do political theory, you may have to go to a cultural studies department, you may even have to go to a philosophy department once in a while, but a political science department is very unlikely to do it. Now, one of the other significant developments in political science is the increasing mathematization of the discipline. So, you know, political science is more and more trying to emulate economics. In fact, the fault lines between the two are slowly disappearing. Right? Model making became very important. And of course, when model making becomes important, what it means is that you create a model and then you try to make the world fit into that model, you know. Right? So political science is simply an illustration of what I would call the utter degradation of an academic discipline. And this is really what I mean when I say the discipline in ruins. And one could go through the similar exercise with respect to economics, where the situation is worse, one would say. One could go through a similar exercise in many other disciplines, whether within the social sciences or elsewhere, but I think in the social sciences the problem is more acute, because the social sciences still have the pretension of being a science to begin with, you know, and the positivist model, I think, is still the predominant model. I think that there are movements on the ground right now which are in some ways rewriting the rules of things that we need to really be looking at. So, for example, politics is the best example. That, you know, what you study in a political science department will have very little relationship, if any, to politics as it's practiced on the ground. Politics as it's practiced on the ground, let's take the example of India. Two, three things come to mind within, you know, a second. For example, the ascendancy of a very low-caste woman to the position of the chief minister of the largest state in India, a state with a population of well over 100 million. Yeah, she's a low-caste Dalit woman. Okay. You're looking at a movement called the Narmada Bachao Andolan, Save Narmada, which is a huge environmental movement in the western states of India, launched in order to protest the construction of a large number of dams, you know, right? Which would, of course, devastate large areas, flood these areas, destroy tribal livelihoods and lifestyles, ecosystems. Now, I don't think the political science departments have at all
caught on to this kind of thing. And when I say that these movements are rewriting the rules, I think at some point they're going to have to compel the political science departments to take stock of what is happening. That is, that the practice always precedes the theory. You don't need somebody in a political science department theorizing about, you know, change on the ground. I mean, the change on the ground is taking place, and 30 years later, the political scientists are going to wake up to that fact.
They'll theorize.
You see, and they'll start theorizing it, you know. Right? But it seems to me that practice in that sense always does precede the theory. So that would be, I think, one arena in which I think the South, the Global South, has a lot more to offer. Because frankly, I don't see that many movements on the ground in the Global North anymore. I mean, you've seen that some of them in relation to globalization and all of that, but even though the Seattle thing was, well, yes, in the Global North, but actually the participation was global in that case.
It's got its fuel from the global.
And this inspiration for that was actually emanating from a large number of groups working in the Global South.